I would like to welcome you to the very first presentation in our 2017 Laureate Lecture Series. Today, we welcome a distinguished speaker from our own faculty, a world-renowned physician scientist and a leader in vision research, Dr. Jose-Alain Sahel. Dr. Sahel, as most of you know, arrived in Pittsburgh just 6 months ago as the Ioneer Foundation professor and the chair of our Department of Ophthalmology. He relocated here from Paris, of course, because who in Paris doesn't dream of moving to Pittsburgh? For the past 15 years, Jose has been professor of ophthalmology at the University of Pierre and Marie Curie, the medical school of the Sorbonne, and chair of ophthalmology at the National Ophthalmology Hospital, which was established by Louis IX in 1260. In 2008, Jose became founding director of the Vision Institute in Paris, a truly extraordinary translational research center focused on understanding the basic biology of vision and finding new therapies for currently untreatable diseases of the eye. Dr. Sahel has guided this institute every step of the way, from when it was an idea that he would not give up on, despite many obstacles, to when it opened with a staff of 30 and through a period of rapid growth to its current size with some 320 investigators and staff. Although Jose is now full-time here in Pittsburgh, he remains engaged with these institutions in Paris. And many of us at Pitt and UPMC are extremely excited about the formal partnerships already established to bridge our respective institutions with Jose as the linchpin. In fact, the Pitt-Paris axis is already being recognized as unique, with the clear potential to be the world's leader in ophthalmology and vision research. Dr. Sahel was born in Algeria, and he earned his medical degree at the University of Paris, after which he completed residency training in ophthalmology, as well as in neurology and neurosurgery. In 1986, he moved to Boston for a research fellowship at Harvard, where he spent 6 years at the Massachusetts Eye and Ear Infirmary and in the lab of Dr. John Dowling, who is known as the founding father of retinal biology and a member of the National Academy. Upon returning to France, Jose began his own series of investigations of the retina in order to understand the group of diseases known as retinitis pigmentosa, genetic conditions that lead to the death of the retina's photoreceptor cells and the consequent loss of vision. Dr. Sahel and his colleagues proposed that there was crosstalk between the two types of photoreceptors such that the rods somehow protected the cones. After many years of investigation, Dr. Sahel et al. Discovered rod-derived cone viability factor, a protein secreted in the normal retina that protects cone photoreceptors. It's since been shown to preserve central vision in several models of heritable human diseases that cause blindness. And a clinical trial for a new therapy targeting this mechanism to prevent vision loss will begin this year. This is just one example of Jose's extensive track record in translational science. He is a co-inventor on numerous patents, several of which have formed the basis of startup companies. Of special interest to Jose, given our aging demographics in Western Pennsylvania, is age-related macular degeneration. I've been trying to avoid the word visionary in this introduction because obviously it can become a cliche when talking about the eye. But it's appropriate here, and it helps to explain why I and many others are so very pleased that Dr. Sahel has joined our faculty. He recognizes that we're on the cusp of a new era in science, as gene and stem cell therapies, as well as immunotherapy, are in clinical trials, and as electronic prosthetic devices and computer-based platforms for vision are very much on the horizon. He also sees the special potential in our region, with Pittsburgh at the nexus of big data and machine learning and of precision medicine and of translational science. Dr. Sahel has been widely recognized for his many achievements. His honors include the Emilia Valori Prize of the Academy of Sciences of France and the Laura Liggett Gund Award from the Foundation Fighting Blindness. He has been elected to the Academy of Sciences of France, the National Academy of Sciences of Germany, and the Collège de France, the highest honor granted to French scientists. He is a member of 11 editorial boards, including those of the Journal of Clinical Investigation and Science Translational Medicine. Finally, I want to note that Jose is first and foremost a passionate physician and researcher, but he is also a transcendent and inspiring person with a broad and deep knowledge and love for the arts, as well as for the sciences. We are fortunate indeed both to have him on our faculty and to have him here today. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Jose-Alain Sahel to present his talk, Sight Restoration from Neuroprotection to Artificial Vision.
Well, thank you very much, Art. Exactly a year ago, I was flying into Pittsburgh, a city I had never seen before. I heard about it, but never knew that I would land there. And I met, on that day, Art Levine, Steve Shapiro, and several people in the audience. And after one day, I started to be convinced that this could be the right place for me to continue my career and endeavor to fight blindness and to try to bring to patients affected with inherited or age-related very severe diseases, very debilitating diseases, the potential for new therapies. So it's quite striking to me that a year later I'm on this podium and I'm hearing Art talking about me and wondering if he's talking about me really or someone else. So I'm just trying to cope with his expectations, and I know that UPMC also has a lot of expectations, but beyond that, I hope that patients have expectations, and even more important, that we'll be able someday to fulfill some of them. So I started as a physician only many years ago, and I was struck with the fact that there are wonderful progress in ophthalmology, in cataract surgery, in glaucoma surgery, in retinal detachment surgery, a few drugs available in the 20th century, but there are many diseases like age-related macular degeneration and congenital or hereditary ocular diseases where we had absolutely no treatment. And the best way for us to think we are so good was just to ignore these patients and don't tell the families or the patients, sorry, we can't do anything, so go to a low vision place and come back 10 years from now, 20 years, or I never came back. And I thought it was really a frustration for all of us. When you get into a medical school, you don't want to have to say that, and you want to ignore that, but this is not what we should do. So I decided quite late in my career to embark into research in parallel to my clinical endeavor. I still see patients and love to see patients. And I was very fortunate that over the years, I was joined by many people, and we were able to try to bring a few advances towards patients. So I'm going to talk about a few of them. You'll think it's too many, you'll see. You'll tell me at the end of the talk it was too many things. But actually, I'm not going to talk about very important research we're also conducting on gene therapy, for example, which I will be pleased to talk to some of you if you're interested. So I'm going just to focus on something which is trying to keep whatever is left, and when everything is lost, how to recover part of it. So these are my disclosures. As Art said, I founded many companies. I think I hold around 40 patents. So I've been very involved, and I think partnering with companies is a very great way to develop new initiatives and new therapies to patients, as long as we remain independent and not conflicted. So it's always a challenge, but I work hard on it, and so far have been quite successful. So I'll start with vision. I guess all of you, if you are here, are interested in vision. We have to remember that the real organ for vision is not the eye, it's the brain. But it starts at the level of photoreceptors. Light is hitting these cells, which are in the depth of the retina, and this sends an electrical signal through the optic nerve to the brain. And this is where we see. The brain is the real organ for vision. So anything we do is trying just to provide enough information to the brain. Then he's able, in conjunction with all the senses, the experience, the memory, to make sense out of it and to live with it. So it was said many years ago that if we don't have the eyes, we are blind. But actually, we have to realize that we are blind to most of the radiations that are around us. Light is a very small portion of a spectrum of radiations. It's a very limited portion. It's amazingly small as compared to everything. So we know about sounds, we know about ultrasounds, we know about radio, about many things. And it's amazing how many radiations we just don't observe. And we are so fortunate that nature has created this very small organ, which is the eye, and even more important in the depth of this organ, the photoreceptors, which are, as their name says, able to transform light, photons, into electrical signal, and this electrical signal is then conveyed through the optic nerve to the brain. But were it not for these photoreceptors, we won't be able to see the colors, we wouldn't be able to see anything, so we rely strongly on that. On this picture, I'm also showing a picture of images of the fundus of the eye, which is the retina. As you may know, the retina is very thin, 300 micron, and in the center of the retina, there is a small area which is 300 micron diameter called the macula. It means in Latin a dot. It has a different color, as you can see. And the macula is where we read, is where we recognize faces, is where we do most of the very sophisticated things we have to do in everyday life and we love to do in everyday life. So we are relying on two very small discs of 300 micron in diameter and less than 300 micron in thickness for most of what we do in life. So this is very precious. And beyond that, we have the rest of our retina, which is helping us to move and to do many things. So what happens when these photoreceptors are two types? Some are called rod photoreceptors. They function in the dark, and they are able to detect one photon in principle. Actually, we need 10 photons to activate them, but this is the minimal amount of light. And then the cones are starting to work, and they are able to go up to seeing the sun, which, of course, we should avoid. We know that since the plateau, and it's clear that we shouldn't never look at the sun, never gaze at it. So we are able to function in both very small levels of light, extremely small and extremely high. And this is because we are fortunate as primates to have these two systems very efficient. At the same time, the cones are more central, as we will get back to in a moment, and the rods are more peripheral. We have three types of cones for the color vision and only one type of rod, which is able to function in the dark. This is the matrix of cone photoreceptors in the retina, very small dots all around the retina, 130 million cells, which are the matrix of cells we have in the fundus. Beyond that, the retina has to be viewed as part of the brain. My mentor, it was mentioned already, John Dowling, wrote two editions of a book called The Retina, An Approachable Part to the Brain. Retina is part of the brain. It's not a peripheral organ, it's part of the brain. And at the developmental level, at the physiological level, it's not just to emphasize how important it is, it's real. And why is this so? It is because beyond detecting the light, there is a huge amount of processing, like a computer, and we'll get back to that later. The signal, which is initially proportional to the intensity of light, is processed by opposing matters. Like in a computer, you can create a zero and a one out of a signal, and this is then processed to provide spatial contrast and temporal contrast, meaning direction, movement, and also color contrast. We benefit, and we have benefited for centuries since Ramón y Cajal, but more important over the past 20 and 30 years of an amazing amount of work. John Dowling was one of the leaders of that, to understand how the signal is processed in the retina. And in the recent few years, new technologies have come up, like multi-electrode arrays, patch clamp recording, and more recently, a work we are conducting with funding from the NIH Brain Project, which is holographic digital analysis of a retina, whereby we are able to analyze the signal at the subcellular level to stimulate a dendrite and to record from the axon. This is possible, and then this leads to understand that the retina is a matrix of many, many, it's a mosaic of many areas, 130 million, actually less than that, but several million, which are really detecting the light and processing the information. Is this important? Yes, because it creates a lot of science and it creates a model of processing of information. The stimulus is moving across all the photoreceptors and the system is detecting the contrast at the spatial level and at the temporal level. And there is an encoding that takes place all across the billions of neurons and the multi-billion synapses to provide a signal to the ganglion cells which are forming the optic nerve. We have at least 20 types of ganglion cells, and they process the information. This researcher, young in our laboratory, was able to reproduce and to model at the mathematical level the processing of signal in the retina at an accuracy of 95%. The remaining 5% are the most difficult, but it's really very accurate. You can predict and you can record. And this leads to propose a model. For example, if you could dim the light a little bit, this is a student who is now at Stanford. He trained in our lab. And when he looked at his own face and he took a movie, these are 4 cell types of ganglion cells. As I told you, we have 20 cell types. And when you look at someone, you don't see one face. You see 20 faces at the same time with all the areas I was mentioning. And the brain is making sense of all this information which is flowing into the brain. So this tells us how complex the system is, how much we have to understand about the code in the system, but also how difficult it is to mimic that. But it's very important to be able to model that at a mathematical level. Every single cell type, you have a different model, and to see how we can use this information to bring back vision. So going back to pathologies, we mentioned that Art insisted on that, age-related macular degeneration. 30 million people in the world have low vision due to age-related macular degeneration, and around 20% of them are very much impaired with that in daily life, unable to recognize faces, to read, to perform many things. And this leads to a loss of central vision. This is what you find on the NIH website, a loss of central vision, central scotoma. Whereas in retinitis pigmentosa, which is a group of hereditary disease of the retina, there is a loss of peripheral vision and eventually central vision. So people have what we call tunnel vision, and this tunnel becomes narrower and narrower over the years, and eventually, over the course of many years, they become totally blind. In both conditions, although the mechanisms are quite different, there is a loss of photoreceptors. And I insisted on that. If you don't have photoreceptors, you may have all the wiring, but you don't have any vision. So what happens when you lose photoreceptors? You have a circuit available, but you can't do anything out of it. So we embarked into an adventure, an enterprise, to try to see how we could cope with that. And many of us have at the same time. The obvious thing in monogenic disorders like retinitis pigmentosa is once you identify the gene, to correct the gene. 30 years ago, the first location was identified by a British researcher, Shami Bhattacharya. In the early 2000s, the first gene was cloned, and this gene was rhodopsin gene. And people started to think, if we start to identify these genes, we should just correct the gene defect, and that would be it. So this led to a lot of gene therapy studies, and I'm not going to focus on that today, because we have to go to take that as granted already, that this is a great approach, but there are a few limitations. As you may know, and this was a guest speaker a few weeks ago by the dean, and you had this science day, gene editing and CRISPR-Cas is a wonderful technology, and Jennifer Lunda was here and talked about that. She discovered that with Emmanuel Charpentier a few years ago, and this is totally groundbreaking for us. So gene therapy has come a long way, and it's now, as we wrote a few years ago, reached the macula, the center of the retina. A lot of successful trials have taken place. Leber's congenital amaurosis, this was initiated in Philadelphia, and now many places are involved in that. Another trial has been quite successful and is ongoing currently on choroideremia, and many of us are happening. Currently in Paris, we have a study on macular degeneration in the young, Stargardt, Usher, which is leading to both loss of vision and hearing in young patients. And we are going to report very soon on this trial. And we just completed the phase 1b/2a of a trial which was conducted fully in the Vision Institute and then in the Paris Center, which is Leber's hereditary optic neuropathy, a mitochondrial disease leading to blindness. And we have very good results in this phase, which is now in pivotal phase and phase 3 phase in the US and in Europe. So many things are happening with gene therapy. So maybe this should be the end of my talk. We found the genes, we correct the gene, and we are done. So you could go back and eat something. I'd actually... Unfortunately, you will have to fast a little bit longer because there are many limitations. First, the number of genes involved. We know about at least 300 genes involved in monogenic disorders of the retina, which means that every single gene would need another therapy. And it's not a generic thing. You have a pill, you put something into the pill, and you cure the disease. Every single gene has a different mechanism. The stoichiometry of a protein is different. All of that has to be understood. And a single gene can have different types of mutations. One of the best examples is rhodopsin. Rhodopsin, we have at least 400 different mutations with different mechanisms leading to degeneration. So when you think about putting back the gene, it's not that simple. Also, only two trials have really been showing successful results so far, Leber's and choroideremia. The others, we are still waiting for that. So there is complexity, there are many mutations. Also, we don't know everything. It's like the horizon. We go with time to reach it, but it's still further. We still have at least one third of the mutations which are unknown. But more important than that, the patient doesn't come and tell you, I'm going to have retinitis pigmentosa. I still have all my photoreceptors. Please correct my gene defect. I'm waiting for that. Unfortunately, when they come to us, they already lost a lot of cells. And when the cells are dead, whatever you do, you can't put back a gene in a cell which is dead. So what can you do in this stage? You have to cope with what is remaining for the patient. So it's far less ambitious. It's far less telling. You're not curing the disease. You are just trying to cope with whatever is left in the patient. So it's a more humble approach, but more realistic in daily life. Because in all these trials, and we have to go through the challenges of the FDA required approach, phase 1b/2a, which is a safety study. All these studies have to be performed in advanced stages. And when you do that, you are treating patients who lost almost everything because you don't want to compromise the remaining vision. But what are you expecting? How many cells are left? How many have just lost function and are still alive? If you want to see any benefit in these very late stages, you need to think that there are some cells that can be rescued. And unfortunately, this is not true in most of the early trials. This is true in the pivotal trials. This is true in the later phases of a trial. So we have this compromise between safety and efficacy, and we try to find a narrow pathway through that. And this is something which is quite challenging. Another question is, if you intervene late, how long is the effect going to last? Has the cell gone beyond a set point where it's too late to be able to rescue durably the effect? So all of these challenges led me to think many years ago, and initially it was mostly because seeing patients, I knew that when they come to us, they have lost most everything. And second, because we started to see so many mutations popping up, but I knew it was going to be very difficult. So I thought, why not focusing on protecting whatever is left? I was not the only one. A very good group in San Francisco led by Matt Lavelle. Matt Lavelle was using trophic factor, and he was showing some promising effect, which have not fulfilled the promises in the clinic so far. When you look at the retina, these are the mutations in the photoreceptors. First, look at this. This is the most important part of photoreceptors. It's the outside part. It is called the outer segment. This is where the light is captured and transformed into the electrical signal. It's a magical thing. It gave a Nobel Prize to George Wald in 1967. He discovered how the isomerization of one molecule is driving amplification by 1 million and then the visual responses. So these are the rods, these are the cones. But in the retina, once the rods start to degenerate, this is a movie prepared by Moran Eye Center, you start to lose rods, then cones. So this is the sequence of events, rods, then cones start to degenerate, and the inner retina doesn't stay still. There is a lot of remodeling of the connections, a lot of changes. So you may think, then, what can we do? It's lost. Actually, it's a stage process. The process is not occurring over a few weeks. It's occurring over many years. And there is an ample room for intervening at different stages of the disease. If you look at the disease as a progressive disease, you have a loss of the rod photoreceptors. Again, will help us to see in the dark. Then the loss of the cone photoreceptors, they lose the outer segment, the part which is capturing light, so we lose color vision, we lose possibility to read, and eventually there is loss of every single cell type in the retina, except for the inner retina, where you still keep around 50% of the cells with poor connections. So if you rethink about retinitis pigmentosa, it's a rod cone disease, so part of the title is cut, but it's a rod cone disease, loss of the rods, loss of the cones. So the patient loses initially the rods. So the different cell types were discovered by Mark Schutzer in Germany 150 years ago. And then the cones eventually were responsible not only for central vision, but also for light-adapted peripheral vision. They die eventually. And this is when the patient becomes blind. So if we could save the cones, we would not cure the disease, but we would have something which is a common pathway beyond the 300 mutations or at least 50 mutations I was mentioning, which would be a way to prevent blindness. And actually, Paul Sieving, the current head of the National Eye Institute, suggested more than 20 years ago, doing psychophysics in patients, that if we could rescue 50% of the cones, we would keep normal vision. If we could rescue 5% of the cones, we would still be able to orient and perform. And more recently, but not so recently, studied on a gene defect that leads to loss of rod function, but not cone function, which is called congenital stationary nine blindness. The comment was written that if we could transform retinitis pigmentosa into that disease, so you are not curing the disease, you are just changing the disease to a non-progressive status, we would prevent blindness in 1.5 million people across the world. So I embarked on that more than 20 years ago, trying to think what could be the mechanism of cone cell death, because I was very surprised that most of the genes which were published year after year were not affecting the cones. So how come do you have a mutation that leads to the loss of a rod and the cones are dying secondarily and you don't know why? So I listed, this is an old slide which I am just updating all the time, the potential mechanisms. At least I had at that time seven. And we worked in sequence on all of them. And of course, we started with the wrong one, and we ended with the right one. So the first one was that the rods, when they die, are liberating a toxic factor. In the 80s, the very fashionable concept was excitotoxicity. Given that photoreceptors are liberating glutamate, we looked into glutamate excitotoxicity, and we found out that this is a mechanism in early stages of the disease. I'm not going to talk about all of them. We just had a paper in eLife a few weeks ago on the role of microglia in photoreceptor degeneration. Other groups have worked on similar or converging pathways, as I will mention in a moment. But the key hypothesis we demonstrated was that the rods and the cones are interdependent. These two cell types are talking to each other. One cell type degenerates, the other one is degenerating. The sequence is as follows: a mutation in rod photoreceptors, a secondary degeneration in cone photoreceptors, and then progressively the inner retinas suffer. There's a good model of that, which is the RD1 mouse, a very old model which was discovered by a medical student in the 20s in Boston. He was supposed to do sections of a retina for a preparation, and he didn't have photoreceptors, so he got very poor grade, but he was very stubborn, so he said, no, I did it right, so I just did it right. So he did it over and over, and eventually the mice he had got had a mutation which led to the generation of photoreceptors. The gene has been identified in the 90s, and this gene is expressed in rod photoreceptors. It leads in sequence to the loss of photoreceptors after 3 weeks, and after 5 weeks, the cones, which are just a monolayer, are starting to degenerate. So we thought this is the right window of opportunity. At 5 weeks, the rods are dead, the cones are still there. So what we did is we prepared a transplant with a pure layer of rod photoreceptors, We prepared that by a technology which was developed by someone from California, Marty Silverman. He showed the technique to us, and he was hoping we could reconnect the cells. But actually what we observed is that when we transplanted this preparation of photoreceptors in the retina, there was a rescue effect on the cones, not only in the transplanted area, but everywhere. This work was done when someone was a PhD student at that time with me, and is now an MD PhD working with me in Paris. And we showed that this has an effect. All the controls had absolutely no effect, but this effect was linked to a crosstalk between rods and cone photoreceptors. What we did then is do a co-culture study to see whether this was due to a diffusible factor. And in point of fact, we published that as long as you have rod photoreceptors, even if they have a mutation, you are rescuing 50% of the loss of photoreceptors in the retina. So we launched at that time, and I recruited a very good molecular biologist, Thierry Leveillard, a very systematic strategy to identify this factor. It was called by reviewers shooting in the dark. And this is the title of a talk I give sometime, just shooting in the dark, because we just didn't know what we were looking for. Some people call that also a fishing expedition. Usually it's not a good compliment for a grant, so actually, and it was not a compliment. And so we were able to carry that through to make a library of all the genes expressed in the retina, 200,000 genes. It was not a normalized library. Actually, there are 40,000. And these genes were just when the supernatant was tested on the culture of cone photoreceptors. And we screened by 100, then 10, then 1. It took 6 years. And eventually, after 6 years, we identified the factor we were looking for, which is rod-derived cone viability factor. So it didn't have that name, of course. This is the name we gave it at that time. And this factor, when we inject it back into the RD1 mouse retina, it does rescue the photoreceptors. We tested that in our many animal models, for example, the rhodopsin mutant, a rat rhodopsin mutant, and you have a good rescue of cells, but more important, you have a functional rescue. There's a lot of variability because it's subretinal injections, but we had a very strong rescue, and I will get back to this slide in a moment because it's a very important aspect of the research. In order to avoid subretinal injection, we used another vector, which was developed by Leah Byrne, a new recruit to Pitt, who is arriving in April to the department in Berkeley. And this vector was functioning by subretinal, by intravitreal or systemic injection. And what we found out, and if you could dim the light, if you compare the treated versus untreated retina, the proportion of photoreceptors is very strong. This is major. And this is the density of photoreceptors. You can measure the rods and the cones. And actually, so I think it's quite striking, the difference between the untreated and the treated retina. And we got a very good response at the physiological level. This is the electroretinogram. We are recording the FP activity in the retina. So what is RDCVF? It was an unknown factor, didn't exist in the databases. It belongs to a new family of genes, so which we discovered, which is called nucleoredoxin-like proteins. It's a new family. We found two members of the family by in silico data mining. And there are two forms of the gene. There is a truncated form, which is due to an intron retention, which is the trophic factor, RDCVF. And there is a longer form that carries a thioredoxin function. So it's a dual gene that has two functions, thioredoxin and thioredox, and at the same time, a paracrine signaling factor. When we knocked out the gene, there was a degeneration of photoreceptors, as you could expect. It took time. And we could sensitize that by using analysis of oxidative stress. Given that it was a thioredoxin-like protein, we looked at accumulation of monoaldehyde and other derivatives of oxidative stress. And what we found is that in the mutant retina, there is a huge amount of accumulation of MDA, for example, which you don't have in the brain. The gene is not expressed in the brain. So it's very specific to the retina, a lot of oxidative stress. If you induce oxidative stress by exposure to light, zero lux, more light, then a lot of light, you lose photoreceptors progressively. And you can rescue that if you bring back the gene. So this is the untreated versus treated. The gene, the long form, is protecting against the oxidative stress. So the hypothesis is now that the factor is protecting the retina against injuries, and the type of injuries that the retina is suffering are the same ones that the retina needs for living. The retina needs light to function, and retina needs oxygen to function. So light and oxygen are inducing what is called pharmacodynamic damage, and RDCVF is protecting against that. When rods start to degenerate, the light, all the light which was absorbed by the rods, they represent 97% of the cells, is now getting to the poor 3% remaining cones. And at the same time, they get all the oxygen that was supposed to be delivered to the retina. And you have to know that the volume of consumption of oxygen in the retina is the highest in the body. So the amount of oxygen and the amount of light make it a very susceptible tissue. So you lose protection and you have high exposure. How does the factor work? How does the trophic activity work? So Thierry embarked in another daring enterprise, which was to try to identify the receptor. You have to know that most thioredoxin don't have an identified receptor. And he did a very nice study, which took 6 years and published last year, where he was able to identify by binding, the binding to an orphan receptor in the retina, which is a variant of Bcg-in, which is known by oncologists, but it's a variant which is specific to the retina, Bcg-in-1. And this variant colocalizes with RDCVF, but it also colocalizes with a transporter to glutamate called GLUT1. This is the FRET demonstration of a colocalization of the two in the retina. And when you analyze the function, you see that the cell survival is correlated to the uptake of glucose. If you inactivate Bcg-in or inactivate GLUT1, you lose this function. And the effect of binding of RDCVF is lasting a few hours, because then the binding is irreversible. So RDCVF is driving a type of rest. This is the cartoon that cell asked us to put together. So RDCVF is liberated by rod photoreceptors in the intraretinal space, activating Bcg-in-1, which is linking to GLUT1, a transporter of glucose, and probably by allosteric transformation. And then this leads to a very specific mechanism called aerobic glycolysis. This mechanism is producing lactate, a few ATP molecules, two ATP molecules by molecule of glucose, not a very energetic system, but it has another function you see on this cartoon, which is the buildup of carbohydrates, mostly through glycerol free phosphatase and DHAP. So the buildup of outer membranes is controlled by this mechanism. This mechanism had been described in the 30s by Otto Warburg. Otto Warburg got the Nobel Prize in the 30s for this discovery, and this phenomenon is called the Warburg phenomenon, and it's supposed to be, this is what Warburg says, absolutely specific for cancer cells. It's before any activation of oncogenes. This is a very early phenomenon in transformation of cancer cells, and Warburg wrote that he had not found that in any single normal cell. He just had an artifact, which was due to the preparation, he thought, and it was the retina. And he said, the retina is the artifact I got in all my preparation, and interestingly, it's not at all an artifact, and the Krebs, another Nobel Laureate, wrote a paper on that in the 70s. So this mechanism is supposed to be totally specific for cancer cells and for the retina. And interestingly, the more you have cones, the more you see this Warburg effect in the retina. So this effect is linked to the fact that photoreceptors share with cancer cells something. They have to renew their membranes at a heavy rate. Every day, every photoreceptor has to renew 10% of his membrane. So they are renewing the membrane at a very fast rate, and they need incorporation of a lot of carbohydrates to build the membrane. In an editorial that was written in comment in our paper last year, Connie Sepko summarized our discovery. She got the Muse Prize a few weeks ago and was coming to Pittsburgh. So the RDCF is binding to basigin, and this is helping for the buildup of the outer segment. If you lose RDCVF or basigin, you lose the outer segment. If you don't have outer segment, you don't capture light and you don't see. And this is what we had found before that when we did the analysis in the rat. In the untreated rat, there is no outer segment. In the treated rat, we saw this outer segment, which were very thin, and they did explain something that the reviewers in the journal didn't like, that we had a morphological effect, which was like 20% improvement, and a functional effect, which was like 100% improvement. So they didn't buy into that. They told us there is something wrong in your paper. You get a functional improvement, which is too big as compared to the number of cells. And it's because we are not increasing so much the number of cells. We're increasing the functional part of the cell, which is the outer segment. So this is a very promising approach. We have now tested that in many animal models, and other groups have done that in parallel. And it's a very promising approach, which is totally generic, independent from a mutation. We are now preparing a phase 1b/2a trial, thanks to very important funding from Foundation Fighting Blindness and a public investor in France. And the idea is to overexpress RDCVF. We don't need to overexpress too much of it in the retinal pigment epithelium, the supporting cell, in order to help the photoreceptors to maintain and build up their outer segment. So this trial is due to start hopefully by the end of the year. We checked that the preparation, I'm not going to get into too many details, there are many tricks around that. We checked that it was leading to really a functional outcome, a behavioral outcome. So we used another type of mutant, the RD10 mouse, which has a slower degeneration. In the RD10 mouse, when you do what is called optokinetic testing, optokinetic is what you do when you're on the train and look through the window, your eyes are moving all the time, they are just following the landscape and getting back all the time. So the animals have the same thing. When you put them into an environment which is rotating, the bars are white and black and white, and you can modify the interval and you can measure the contrast, and the animal is following that. A normal animal has a very good acuity as measured by this test. An RD10 mouse is losing almost every vision by 40 days. When we put RDCVF, and these are all the controls, you are delaying the loss, and now we have extended the study up to 3 months, which for a mouse is a lot, and it's extending, and there is no change. There is a very strong effect, and if you translate that into clinical, the slope of degeneration of a disease, this would correspond to around 40 years of vision. Of course, if we could just get 10 years of vision, we'd be very happy out of it. So this is where we are aiming at currently, transforming the blinding disease into a stationary disease using this protein. But what happens when you have lost totally the outer segment and you are no longer able to regrow the outer segment? Years ago, we started to collaborate with Botan Roska in Basel at the Friedrich Mischer Institute on an hypothesis which was based on the fact that in the blind retina of many patients, and more important, many animal models which we could analyze, because in patients you have very few post-mortem studies, fortunately, and we could find that in a postdoc in Botan's lab, could find that in many papers there were remaining cone cell bodies, but no outer segment. It's not surprising given what I just told you, but this is the situation. These patients are blind, but they still have cone photoreceptors. They are wired, but there is no outer segment. Can we regrow them? We'll see. If not, there is another possibility, which is restoring light responses in these photoreceptors. And in these years, a new a new avenue in research had started, which is called optogenetics. Optogenetics has been discovered at the Max Planck Institute in Frankfurt by Bamberg and co-workers, has been used by many, many famous people like Carl Deseraud, Ed Boyden. And the idea was to use this type of protein that exists in algae and bacteria and don't exist in humans and mammalians in general. These proteins have a very good privilege. They couple a channel or a pump to a photochrome. They are able to capture the light, and immediately this is transforming into an electrical signal by a channel or a pump. So what we used is a pump, a chloride pump, which exists in the nature, and we overexpressed this pump in the retina. So this was led by Botton Roskine in Basel, in the dormant photoreceptor. We call that dormant cone photoreceptors in blind models of mice, many mice with blindness. So we use that in several models. And Botton and his team were able to demonstrate when you did that, you got light responses in the retina. More important, you got responses in the ganglion cells and behavioral responses with the optokinetic test. So we collaborated on that to bring that to the primate and the human retina. We published together the paper already a few years ago, activating the photoreceptors and recording in the ganglion cells. So this led to a translational project, which is now in a company, from a mouse model to test in post-mortem human retina. We showed that the retina can survive after the death many hours, and we can reactivate the retina after death. We don't resuscitate the dead, but we just resuscitate some cells and reactivate them. It would be too good. And then we move that to a primate retina in order to analyze what vector would be the best and how to deliver that. So with Denise Dalcara, also coming from Berkeley, we analyzed many vectors. This is a primate retina injecting in the subretinal space or in the vitreous, and we identified the best variant for expression. And this is the image of the macula of the treated animals, the primates. At least 25% of cone photoreceptors are transfected. We bumped into a few problems of targeting the protein to the right location. We are still working on that, but we decided to, in parallel, to launch other avenues. Actually, we have 6 optogenetic programs ongoing currently. And the one we conducted was trying to reactivate the inner retinal cells, the ganglion cells, or the bipolar cells. I'm going to focus on, we published already on this one, so I'm going to focus on the ganglion cells just to show you recent results. We got with a protein that is shifted into the red, so it needs far less light and far less energy. And expressing this protein in the macula, we could get very good recording after 3 months and 6 months. It's a very stable effect using multi-electrode arrays and, as I will show, patch clamp recording. So these are the cells, the mid-jet ganglion cells, which are activated. The frequency of fusion is very good, so the eye is really able to perform very well on that. And we got cortical responses in the animal models. So this is now in transition. This protein had been developed by Ed Boyden at the MIT, has been modified, and is now in transition for a clinical trial, which is due to start in the middle of the year. But one of the challenges we have with this protein that was pointed out in a comment by Konisepko to our paper in 2010, so she likes to comment our papers, which is great, and she has wonderful papers too. And so the idea is that these proteins expressed in the retina are very good because they have this great coupling of the ionophore, of the channel and the chromophore, but there is no amplification. In the retina, one photon is inducing the activation of 1 million channels. Here we have one photon, one channel. So we lose a lot of possibilities to adapt to different levels of light, to accommodate and to adapt. And so there is a need to send a lot of light to activate these proteins. And she was proposing that we develop goggles or LEDs to stimulate that. Then we get into something which is going to be probably modern precision medicine, not just biologics, but devices. There is a convergence of the field. What is going to happen in the next few years is developing therapies for regenerative medicines like gene therapy or cell therapy, but at the same time using devices to stimulate that and encoding the signal, as I will talk about in a moment. So what we are developing currently with GenSight is a product which is the vector itself with the protein itself, then the expression in the ganglion cells, and a device which is stimulating that and giving a visual response. Do these devices exist already? You may think yes, because if you remember, even the young audience may remember some of these, even some failures recent. to point towards the idea of virtual reality, immersion reality. So this does exist already, but there is not enough light and not enough encoding. So we had to develop our own system. And we learned a lot from artificial retina. We had been working for the past many, many years on artificial retina, and this was done in conjunction with Marco Imayon and Second Sight. This is a blind patient with artificial retina, and he was able to read a very French sentence. His glass of wine. Yeah. So this patient was able to read that. He was totally blind before. So this patient with this system, and these are the electrodes, and this is why I want to come at. These are the surgeons that did the surgery in my department. And so you see the activation of the electrodes, very few electrodes, and very tricky to be able to see through that. So this patient is reading another sentence, is running fast, which is, can be an American sentence too. And then this, these electrodes are not so many. In the current systems, Second Sight has developed 60 electrodes. In Paris, we have developed 150, but it's not a lot. Remember, we have 130 million photoreceptors. We have 1 million ganglion cells. So how can we get better? We decided to get a better resolution and started to partner with Daniel Palanker in Stanford, who had the idea of using photodiodes to reproduce the activation by light. These diodes are all independent. They have, each diode is activated by light and amplifying. And the idea was to use this system to insert under the retina. I'm just fast forwarding it a little bit. So we are injecting panels of, so like solar panels, but smaller, obviously, into the eye. And these panels are injected under the retina. So we have done that now in mice, rats, and primates, and we are waiting for the approval for human trials. And then you have these goggles that are sending the light in order to activate these panels. So these panels are subretinal, as you remember. We injected them there. And they are activated by this red light. So this flower, this time it's a flower, which is used, not a woman, to stimulate the cells. And you see this activation, and then it gets to the brain. What this technology has in common with optogenetics is that you need to send light to activate this type of responses in the retina. So we thought, why not taking benefit of that to restore part of the encoding? I started my talk with the encoding occurring in the retina. If we just reactivate the photoreceptors, we don't reactivate the encoding. So we thought, all the knowledge that has been accumulated over a century on the encoding, why don't we use it to optimize the signal in the retina? We could maybe provide through these cameras, which may look as a disadvantage, an advantage, which is to provide a signal that would be understandable by the brain. So this is the movie I showed a moment ago. This is the mathematical model which had been developed. And Riad Ben-Osmond, working with me in Paris and Serge Picot, developed with Christophe Bosch a type of camera that are functioning like the retina. These are totally new cameras. These cameras are not functioning like classical camera. A classical camera is deriving from a history of painting. Every film we look at is a series of pictures, still pictures, and you just think this is moving because every 30 milliseconds there is a change. But when you take a picture or a movie, whoever in the audience is sleeping will be taken. But everyone who is moving is going to provide some information. In this type of, in the retina, this is not what's occurring. If you are not moving, if you are sleeping, you don't appear at all to the retina. If you are moving a little bit, you create a signal. And why does the retina see still objects? It's because we have small movements of the eye all the time called saccades, very small movements that refresh the signal. So the idea was to create cameras that instead of functioning like classical cameras, would for every single pixel detect changes and only changes like photoreceptors do. And so these cameras have been developed and they have been implemented into this projector, which is projecting the signal into the eye. How do they work? So this is Riad Ben-Osmond. These are the cameras which were developed at the Institute. And these cameras with all the circuits are mimicking the signal we record from the retina, all the mathematical model we discussed about, and they are detecting only changes. So the image looks blurred as compared to a classical image, but the amount of data is divided by two log units. So you are decreasing the amount of data to process, and more important, this is how the retina works. So there's a new company that has been formed that is using these cameras for car driving. Intel invested into it and Nissan, and they use this pixel-independent camera. So this is what they do. Instead of taking pictures, they only detect changes, and each pixel is detecting the changes, and then you make sense out of it in the brain. So these cameras have been now implemented into these new goggles we developed. They capture the image, and you have this projector sending the image into the eye to stimulate the reactivated cells or the subretinal chip that we implant. So there are two wavelengths, one for the artificial chip. So the same system applied to two different technologies, optogenetic or vision restoration. But going back to patients, we have all these potential therapies, gene therapy, neuroprotection, artificial retina, optogenetics. I don't talk about stem cells. We also carry projects on that. Are we going to use everything for every patient? Is one going to cure everything? Certainly not. As I said, the retina is evolving over time. And when we talk about precision medicine and personalized medicine, it's not just talking about genes. It's talking about the status for every single patient of his tissue and his function. So what is the status of the remaining retina? If you look at the, this is a recent review we published a few weeks ago, and we, this is what happens. You have loss, normal patient has normal photoreceptors, then you start to have loss of rods and cones, and then you have total loss of photoreceptors. And the therapies that you can propose do apply at various stages of the disease. If you still have everything available, you may want to try gene replacement, gene editing, pharmacology, neuroprotection. If you are starting to lose the cells, you may want to protect them. If you have lost everything, you need to revert to prosthetics or stem cells or other approaches. How do we know how many cells are left in the retina? So we are very fortunate because over the past decades, wonderful technologies have been developed. The former chair of the department, Joel Schumann, was involved in the discovery of OCT, ocular coherence tomography, which is a way to realize cross-section of a retina technology, which was developed at the MIT. And Joel was in Boston at that time, and he was really involved in this work. And they showed that you can realize, initially the images were very poor, but now they get very high resolution using Fourier transform and many algorithms. You get very good images of the layers of a retina. It's like a histological section, not yet, but almost, of a retina. In parallel, a group at Rochester and us in Paris, we worked on another approach, which is called adaptive optics. Adaptive optics is a technology that astronomers use to look into the sky and to see the stars. What they do, they send a beam of light into the sky, and the atmosphere is transforming the light. It's inducing a lot of aberrations, and the light which is reflected to a captor is totally distorted because the atmosphere is impure. And they use mirrors that can modify to correct for this aberration. So the giant telescopes that are used worldwide to see the stars and to observe new planets are gigantic systems over kilometers, which are used by the astronomers to correct the aberration of light in the atmosphere and to see through that. So David Williams in Rochester, who was the mentor of Ethan Rossi, who is now with us in Pittsburgh, had the idea of applying to this technology. And in parallel, an astronomer in Paris contacted us and said, why don't we apply this technology to the eye? You are suffering from the aberrations of light when they get through the eye. Why don't we do the same? So we thought, well, the telescope is going to be a little bit big for my department. So what can we do about that? So we worked on miniaturizing that, and many people did. You still see these big machines, but it's possible to get a smaller machine. So what happens is now, thanks to this technology, you have the OCT, and you get all these layers in the retina, analyze the outer segment, the photoreceptors, the ganglion cells, the bipolar cells. This is Ethan Rossi, a new recruit, my first recruit here, thanks to Art and all of you, and Michel Pack, a professor in my department in Paris, and they collaborate on this project. And this is the adaptive optics imaging. Every single dot you see here is a cone photoreceptor. So in 1 minute, we can get a mapping of the cone photoreceptors in the eye. So we know exactly how many cells are left in the eye in this patient. There are a lot of artifacts. We work on that, but this is very wonderful. And this is, for example, a comparison between a normal patient. This is the OCT. This is the adaptive optics imaging, the density of cone photoreceptors. And this is a cone dystrophy. A patient is losing outer segment and is losing the matrix of photoreceptors. For the sake of time, I'm not showing too much on that, but it helps us to stratify the cohort of patients into patients who have lost part of the outer segment or who have lost everything. For example, this patient we put in the paper as a good candidate for optogenetics. One of the issues is that these patients are moving the eyes very fast. When they don't have good vision, especially the young children, Ken knows that very well, they have nystagmus. The eye is moving very fast, so you don't get good images. So we are working currently on a very fast performing system. I got a very big grant on that to develop very fast system to record at very high speed. We are not the only ones to do that, obviously. And also another approach is to get to the cellular level, and Ethan is currently developing an in vivo biphoton microscope in partnership with Rochester, which would be a wonderful tool. So from that, we can certainly develop new studies, prospective studies, to follow cohorts of patients. And these are the type of cohort that we are following currently. I just show you what we have done in a large cohort of 7,500 patients followed over the past 10 years in Paris. We look at every single parameter in the patient, a database of patients. We have the mutations when available, and we have all the parameters, visual function, and all the changes you can observe in the eye. And this way, you can monitor what happens in the disease. And what we see is that over a year, you lose between 1 and 4% of the parameters. And this is a good way to monitor the evolution of the disease in order to prepare the trials, to select the patients that are really evolving, and also to demonstrate the benefit in these patients. Getting back to patients, this is my last part of my talk. How can we demonstrate, and again, it is precision or personalized medicine, but there is a real benefit. We tend to think, as ophthalmologists, that if we improve visual acuity, we are done. Patient is seeing on the chart, he's happy. We are doing a visual field, he's seeing the dots, that's great. Many patients tell us, okay, it's great, I go to your office, I see what you show me, but I go back home and I can't perform. The vision I have is not so useful. For example, if you have 20/20 vision and the visual field like that, what do you do with that? What can you do with that? If you don't adapt to light changes, how do you deal with that? So you have to find another way to measure a benefit in therapy. Also, the FDA, to register the drugs and to provide approval, they want a strong demonstration that there is a real benefit, not just a benefit for the doctor, but a benefit really for the patient and society. And now they're asking us to demonstrate that 1-9 visual acuity improvement is significant, is meaningful, and we have to get out of the comfort zone. We have to be out of the comfort zone. I think Jeff Romov is saying that all the time, but we have to get out of the comfort zone. We have to innovate. And innovating is trying to see how meaningful is vision in daily life. And we have to get into something which is quite messy. It's called patient-reported outcomes and performance-based testing. Patient reporting outcome is what patients tell us about the disease. They fill questionnaire, they tell you what they can do and not do, and they are most of the time building themselves the PROs. They are successful. Patient reported outcomes are not made by the physician, they are not made by a statistician, they are made by patients themselves when they tell us what is so important. A few weeks ago, actually it was the day of the election of a new president, we were in Washington at the FDA discussing these items. And it was very clear that the future lies in the hands of the patient, not just because they are so strong in expressing themselves now, but also because they are providing the key information, what is meaningful, what is not meaningful for us. And one of the issues is not only to rely on questionnaire, but also to demonstrate a change in performance. It is called performance-based testing, which means that you have to standardize something which would be as close as possible to daily activities. Recently, there was a paper reviewing virus approaches. You can have what is called the laboratory approach, which could be a clinical approach, with a standard test, which is simple. You control everything. The patient is told what he has to do. Absolutely not naturalistic. And the patient is restrained. It can't move. He's just sitting and doing that. The alternative is simulators. We build simulators, and there is a wonderful one here in Pittsburgh for vestibular disorders, where patients are shown moving environment. It's quite naturalistic. They can't move so much, but it's quite useful. The best is probably to move toward what is called a naturalistic environment, where you can really mimic the complexity of daily life, monitor every parameter, embed that into the behavior in the patient, and monitor everything, eye movement, head movement, behavior. So we built that, this environment, building both a simulator, an apartment, and more important, an artificial street. In this artificial street, we can control the lighting, absolutely from any type of lighting, color, everything. It could be a great day, a wonderful sunny day, Pittsburgh time, wherever, whatever you want. And you can use that to control. We can control the sound because we have to remember that we live in a multi-sensory environment. And then we are monitoring what happens to the patient. We put captors on the head, on the eyes, eye movement, and on the body, and we use Vicon cameras to monitor the patient. So I show you a short movie of what the patient is doing. This is the light control. This art has seen that, and Jeff Romov has seen that too. This is what we do for the sound. We have these Vicon cameras that are really monitoring the movement. We put inertia captors or infrared captors, and we create an avatar of the subject, was, for example, to do a task like putting a letter in the post office or more complex tasks that the patient is asked to do. So we monitor that. We are controlling all the parameters. There is a dialogue with the patient, and then you can follow what the patient is doing in the arena, talking to the patient all the time. For example, here he has to move and to post this letter, but you'll see, more important, he will have to move in an environment, and this is what you will see very, very soon, hopefully. So these are the captors we put. These are infrared emitters, and these captors are then monitored by these Vicon cameras, and you get an avatar of the subject. What do you do out of that? You monitor what is called vision for action. A lot of vision is used for moving, for acting. So what we do is, for example, for patients with very small narrow field, we ask them to move into the room to avoid obstacles and to get through the door. This is the direction of gaze. The patient is looking at that. This is what they do. This is how they move. Or the patient is moving. This is the gait, how the feet are moving. And we are currently conducting a study comparing different types of visual field and correlating that with the performance of the patient. This should lead to statistically significant measurement. I just show you an example of gait. This is the walking cycle, and this does apply for vision, but also after stroke and in aging in general. There is a lot of studies on aging on that. So we are monitoring the trajectory, the head direction, and as you can see, if you compare an RP patient as compared to a normal subject, there's a huge difference in the head direction. So you can really quantify this impact. The same is true for eye movement, for the direction of the body, and for the amplitude of eye movement. But remember, I said that the most important part of vision is taking place in the brain, so we also have to look at what happens at the cortical level. And we have to look at the plasticity, because if we restore vision, we are not going to restore vision in a blank brain, which is just waiting for the doctor for seeing again. Yes, over the years, the patient have developed adaptive mechanisms, new connections. For example, we just published that there are new connections between the reading area and the motor areas, and we have to take that into account in the subject. And this leads to a real challenge, which will be my last point, is that we talk all the time, and it's terrible, about transhumanism. We talk about the $6 million, and I hope it won't cost that much. But remember that this can be a nightmare. This book was written by someone who so-called benefited in the 70s from cortical implant. People put electrodes in the brain in a blind person, and he was searching for paradise. And his life was hell, absolutely hell. It was terrible. And we have to remember that we are not dealing with just a car, we are fixing the car, we are dealing with a human body, a human being that has to get back into his life with better performance, useful performance, and we have to monitor that as good as possible. So it's a huge endeavor. It's going to take the work of many people in Paris, but more important now in Pittsburgh, and we have this very big ambition on that, and I know it's now a priority here to work on that, so I'm very happy about that. Regrowing the optic nerve, doing many other things just to restore vision. I just put a few names. I mentioned some of them in passing, and I won't have the time. But we have to realize that we are not there. We are just starting. And I like to quote Winston Churchill, who said, it's not the end. It's not even the beginning of the end. It's perhaps the end of the beginning. So see where we are currently. Thank you very much.